As they all journey to the surface, Regina and Celia remember the day Celia's parents died. On that fateful day, the entire mobile fortress was attacked, and all the young ones and people who couldn't fight had to go into hiding. They hid in a secured shelter, but they could still hear the noises of the battle, the sounds of the bombs, and the effects of the battle. In fact, at a point, their light goes off and suddenly comes back. It isn't a surprise that the young kids are scared. To comfort each other, they speak about irrelevant things, and eventually, they fall asleep. The following day when the battle ends, the door to the shelter opens, and they see light again. They come out of their shelter to a destroyed city. Almost all the nobles who had engaged in that battle and fought died in the battle. Thinking about her parents, Celia bends to the ground and starts crying. Immediately, Regina tries to console her as they both think of what life has for them. At present, they drive Leo to the 7th Mobile Fortress. Leo sees the building from afar and asks them if that is where they are going. They explain to him how important the fortress is to them and how they protect the place. In fact, Celia declares that it is the place they are protecting, and she would do anything to protect the fortress. She is no longer ready to deny her identity and her duties. They eventually arrive at the fortress, which is really bigger than Leo had expected. It is really more than that. He calls the place an island, but they correct him that their fortress is a mega float. It isn't really on the ground, and they are trying to push it toward the ocean to attack the void from behind. And eventually, win the fight. As they have this conversation, Celia receives a call talking about how she has sent the information about the kid to the government. Leo had healed her when she was almost dead, and even if she didn't take him, she was already under his administration. Leo is entirely lost in the conversation. He doesn't understand what they are saying and what they mean, so he asks them to explain better. They narrate to him that they think he is one of the lost children from Boyd's invasion, and they are sure his family must have been searching for him. So they will find his home for him. Celia tells him that before he finds a home, he can join the academy. As she tries to explain how the academy works to him, Regina excuses herself and asks to go to the market and get everything they need. Regina walks away from them, and Celia informs Leo that before he can join the academy, there are some processes that he must follow, so he has to stay in that place for some tests. The tests are standard procedures that all new members who visit them go through. The academy is a place where young kids who are given great powers by the gods to defeat voids are trained in exchange for fighting and protecting the city. The academy would give them all a new life. Following her concise explanation, she asks him to enter the building, and she will meet him later at the gate. She immediately zooms off with her bike, and he enters the building. He is bothered by a lot of things. Sincerely, things weren't going as planned. Before he went into deep sleep about 1,000 years ago, humans have advanced a lot. There have been several civilizations and growths. They now have other enemies they are fighting against, which are the voids. And even if he is ready to fight them, does he think he can do well considering that he looks like a kid? To survive in that environment, he needs to do more. He decides to call his maid from his former world and his best friend. He calls out for Petrie and Dish, who are seeing him for the first time in about 1,000 years. They immediately hearken to the voice of their master and they greet him. They claim they had also been in deep sleep all these years, and they are really glad to see him. But Dish asks him what is the deal about his new body. He is forced to explain that his reincarnation had failed, and to return to the shape he was when he was still human. He recalls that the reason Dish wouldn't know how he looked when he was a human hero was because he met Dish after he had become a demon lord. While Dish is indifferent about his new look, Petrie comments that he really looks cute, and the new figure fits him. She immediately sees that he doesn't like the statement, and he apologizes immediately. He calls them lowly beings and says that he has come to ask them for a favor. He has a mission for them, and they are up and ready to do whatever he wants. Looking around, they have also seen that humans have changed. They aren't the same and civilized people that they left about 1,000 years ago. And Leo admits that things have changed in such a way that he needs more information before he can make a move. He asks them to help him gather all the information they can gather around and for them to find out everything humans have been doing in anticipation of the return of the Demon Lord. Well, It seems humans haven't been doing much since they don't even know anything about the demon lord. He pleads with his servants to be very careful and warns them not to use any device that could expose them, since humans are very much on their feet and they don't want to be caught. Petrie wonders what Leo's next course of action will be and if he will follow them back to their hidden place, but he claims he isn't going. He is in a human body, and the body has needs. He needs clothing, food, and shelter, and the best way for him to get it is to pitch with humans. He informs them that he will be staying at the academy along with the people who had reached him, so he can use that opportunity also to find more about humans and learn their newest culture. He dismisses them, and they promise to take their mission seriously. After they leave, he enters the institution for his test. The first door he passes through takes him into a room with long pipes around. He wonders what the room is for and what the pipes are doing there, but suddenly, liquids from the pipe pour on him in washing. However, when he enters the door, the lights increase, and red lights start showing. A loud noise also comes out from the system, and he is very scared. Fortunately, the light does turn off as it should, and the noise stops. He leaves the door and proceeds to the next one with no expectation of what more he will meet. However, it's the end of the process as he receives his identity card in front of that door. He looks at the plastic card, but Celia comes behind and takes it from him. She explains the card would serve as proof of his identity until he is accepted fully by the administration. However, she has to take a record of the card so she can have a concise record for her submission. She takes a picture of the card and returns it to him. As they return to her bike, she feels a little weak, and she says that she needs to rest at home before returning to the administration for her training. She reveals to him that she hasn't awakened her power and she wants to keep fighting and training until she can awaken her powers. He wonders what rationale the gods could use in sharing such power if someone as courageous as Celia hadn't awakened her power. Regardless, she offers to take him around the environment so he can at least see the sake of Gaku and before he follows her to her dormitory. They ride around the city, and he sees the happy people around. He recalls that the city is meant to be fighting a war, and he can't explain why there are so many happy people everywhere. He asks her why the city looks so peaceful, and she explains to him that only the experienced warriors are taken to the battlefield. The mobile fortresses are secured, and they ensure that voids do not attack them, which is why everyone there is peaceful. She eventually reaches Sekiakuin. The building is so huge and it is really big. She shows him the administration and tells him that Sekiakuin is the central military body of the entire city and that is where all their direct commands come from. He doesn't give the kind of expression she is expecting. She expects him to be very shocked at how huge the building is, and she also tells him that everyone who sees the building for the first time is always very excited. However, what he is thinking about is much different. He wonders how to infiltrate a building like that without losing the battle. She takes him on a tour inside the building and shows him his class where he would receive all his lectures, the library with several books, the dance hall, and even the bathhouse. While he could understand why they had a training room and a library, he didn't understand why a school would have a dance hall. Well, all work and no play would make them dull students. She responds in the same way and acknowledges that there is a need for them to have fun when they are tired. They start walking to the dorm. She shows him the girls' dormitories, and he also notices that all the ladies who pass beside them give great comments about how he looks. This makes Celia tell him he would be popular. Their fun trip soon turns sour when Celia meets a senior she dislikes. The senior had always been flirting with her, and on that day, he asks her what she is doing with the child and asks if her weak platoon is now babysitting children. He reminds her that if she doesn't awaken her power soon, she will be sent away from the school. So he advises that she join his platoon to become his play toy and secure her space in this school. She refuses his offer and tries to walk away, but he gets triggered and drags her hair. This makes Leo angry. He uses his power to terrify the guy, and he bows to Leo's feet. The senior refuses to give up, so he brings out his weapon, but another senior steps in to remind him that the use of their regime isn't allowed in the school, and he is also trespassing by visiting the female dorm. He walks away embarrassingly, and Celia appreciates the female senior. The lady proceeds to ask about Celia's mission and apologizes for not following her. She takes Leo's measurement for his uniform, and Celia feels weak again. Sally rests on the tree for a while and continues the tour later. They eventually get to Celia's dorm. The dorm looks much older than the other dorms Leo has seen on his way, so she explains to him that the school is based on merit, and you can only get great rooms if you are one of the most intelligent in the school. She stops by Regina's room, but Regina is asleep, and she takes Leo to her room. She asks Lou to have his bath. As he does that, she asks him if he would like to join her platoon. Moon, her platoon, is weak because she doesn't have power, but she needs to seal her stay in the school. She enters the bathroom to meet him naked, and he is nervous. She feels she is just a big sister to him, so she even offers to help him wash his hair with shampoo. He reluctantly accepts, and as she does so, she informs him that with his healing power, every platoon will be all over him. She claims she won't be angry if he doesn't join her, and she would like them to remain friends. However, he actually intends to join her. He fears that he would only be at the mercy of other people if she is faced with danger and asks her why she really wants to be in that school when she knows she doesn't have power. In her defense, she claims she wants to be able to protect herself. Suddenly, she faints. Leo drags her closer and puts her mouth on his vein. He reveals to her that he has lied. He tells her he doesn't have healing powers, and he only has dark powers. He tells her the real her has died in the ruins. At the end of the episode, Patreon-divide themselves to find information faster. Do you think Leo would continue with his mission to destroy humans?